want you to know that even to this day, all of that learning stayed with me to the point that even in my house, even now, fellas, in my house, when it's my turn to clean the house, everybody gets upset. Because when it's my turn to clean the house, I don't ask a whole lot of questions. I don't move stuff around and ask, where should I put this? If it's in the way, I'm throwing it in the trash. Amen, amen. So I got a few witnesses here. Amen. That's how I clean. I throw it in the trash. If you got a toy in the way, if you don't pick it up, amen, it's going to the curb. Amen. Because that's how I clean the house. That's how I clean the house, because I'm not satisfied just moving stuff around and just sweeping dirt under the rug. You have to actually get down and dirty and move some stuff out. And there's some folk that instead of throwing stuff out, things that you don't need anyhow, they begin to produce clutter in your house. Then your house ends up junky. Your house ends up a mess, a hot mess. Your house is full of clutter and it's just nasty. Come on, somebody, say it's nasty. If you don't get rid of some of this junk, amen, it's just nasty. Now, there are some folk that have, you know, they got everything. They're pack rats. They just pack everything. They don't throw anything away. And let me say that there's some people, I know you're here this morning, that'll say, well, if it's in my house, it's my junk, and I know where everything is in that junk, so it's going to stay there. Amen. But I want you to know it becomes a problem. It's good. It's all well and good when it's your junk and you know what's in your junk. But the problem is when your junk becomes a mess to somebody else. It's a problem. It's a problem when your negative mess has an impact on other people around you. What I'm trying to say is that when your junk hits the streets and has a negative impact on the community, then that's when we need to go forth and clean the house. Niecy Nash would call it mayhem and foolishness. And I want you to know that our spiritual house is just as important as our physical house. And there are some folk that have some junk in their trunk, skeletons in their closet, and dirt and dust underneath of the rug. And in this season, God is looking for some folk that don't mind cleaning the house. Understand, this was precisely what happened in the Corinthian church. They were messy. They were junky. They were nasty with one another. But it got so bad that it started to leak out into the Gentile community. The word on the street was that even the heathens on the street were saying, we know we bad, but they even worse in the church. And I want you to know, history has a way of repeating itself. And on any given day, you can go down on the street corner and talk to anybody on the street, and they can tell you more about what's going on in most of these churches than some folk can tell you that are in the church, because our junk is in the street. It's what I call nastiness, mayhem, and foolishness. And it's time to clean out the house. You don't believe me? It's right here in the text. Paul said it is reported commonly that there is fornication among you. He said these are not rumors. This is not hearsay, but this is a full report. And Paul here is writing this letter to the church at Corinth to restore order in the church. Sometimes the key to setting your house in order is you've got to have the courage to clean your house. Have I got a witness today? Now, he said it's reported commonly that there is fornication nation among you. Not out in the streets, but in the church house. Let me help somebody understand. I was taught at an early age that fornication was just, you know, intimacy outside of the marriage. But when you exegetically examine the origins of this word fornication, you will see that it means much more than that. When he talks about fornication, it's not just two teenagers in the back seat of the car having a good time. It's not just two people that are getting hot and ready in the back of the movie theater, but fornication has a broad meaning. When you dig into the text, you'll discover that the Greek term for fornication is pornei, P-O-R-N-E-I, which is where we get the word porn or porno. This is indicative of the fact that fornication encompasses all sexual immorality. I'm teaching in here whether you like it or not. It encompasses everything, which is why I don't understand how some folk pick on certain sins and leave other sins out of the equation. When you do your study and you go back and check behind me, you'll see that fornication means adultery. That means cheating. You know, you've seen that show called Cheaters. It means cheating on your spouse, running on your husband, running on your wife, wife swapping, husband swapping. This was going on in the church. It also means single or unmarried individuals engaging in intimate relations one with another and don't have a marriage or a marriage license or a ring on their finger. That's what it means. Fornication also means and includes homosexuality, lesbianism, and also bestiality, because back in those days, some folk didn't want a man, they didn't want a woman, they go get a dog or a cat, or they go get a pig or a sheep. It's even in the Bible, according to Leviticus chapter 18. I'm teaching in here today. Some of y'all just want me to hoop and holler, but I got to give you something to hoop and holler about. Even in Bible times and even to this day, incest is also included under the umbrella of fornication. That means having sexual relations with close relatives, your mom, your dad, your sister, your brother, and your cousin too. This is all included under the heading of fornication. Some folks say, well, Pastor, you never say anything about homosexuality from the pulpit. Well, homosexuality is just as bad as that brother in the church that's running around on his wife. There's no big sin. There's no little sin. Now, sin is still sin. Have I got a witness, church? If you are shacking, you're just as bad as a homosexual. Amen, lights. Amen, walls. Come on, somebody. You need to put a ring on that finger. Come on, somebody. 2013 is the year to clean house. Come on, somebody. We ought not have any officers, any leaders, any preachers, any deacons, anybody that is not, come on, somebody, living according to the standards that are set in the Bible. Don't just pick on gay folk. Don't just pick on lesbians, but pick on everybody, because all of us got some stuff with us. Some of y'all didn't say amen. I guess you're clean. But is there anybody here that knows Jesus said, even if you look at a woman and lust, come on, somebody, you've already committed the sin in your heart. You all know how some brothers do, how they look. Come on, somebody. They'll sit right in the right spot in the service. You know, they love sitting in the back so they can get a good view of everything that's, come on, coming from behind. And you know what they say? They'll tap the brother. It must be jelly because jam don't shake like that. You know what I'm talking about. And these brothers are right in the church. They're in the church. They're in the church. And that's just as bad as homosexuality. It's all sin. And the wages of sin is death. I know some of you all watch the show called Scandal. Some of you love Scandal, but there's scandal even in the church. There's scandalous behavior going on even in the body of Christ. And Paul here takes the time to address this issue in the church, because not only does he say fornication to include everything, but specifically in verse 1, he shows us that there was a brother in the church. We don't know if he was a minister in training. We don't know if he was on the deacon board. We don't know if he was an usher. It was a brother in the church that was sleeping with his stepmother. Help me, Holy Ghost. Now, it doesn't say whether or not his father was deceased or whether his father and his stepmother were divorced, but that still doesn't make a difference. According to Leviticus chapter 18, it's still a sin. I mean, who in their right mind would think to have an intimate relationship with your stepmother? Lord, just even the thought of it makes me say, ooh. Who in their right mind would want to do a thing like that? This brother was having a relationship, not just they were shacking up. They were living together. It was known. It wasn't a rumor. It wasn't hearsay. It was reported that this brother was going with and sleeping with his stepmother. And Paul addresses the situation because Paul ain't scared. Paul said, you all are so puffed up. You're so arrogant and you're so self-concerned and self-serving that you will not stand up and address the issue. I found that a lot of preachers preach all around issues because they don't want to deal with it because it's in their house too. Amen, lights. Amen, walls. But I came to tell you, when you come to Galilee, you're going to get a well-rounded word, because if it's in this here Bible, Scott's going to preach about it. Have I got a witness, church? Whether it hits my house or not, it's tight, but it's right. You ought to give somebody a high five and say, he's telling the truth. He's telling the truth. He's telling the truth. And I came to serve notice on the enemy that we have tiptoed through the tulips in the church for long enough. We need to address these issues in the house. Have I got, now for all of our guests, don't you think that we're a bunch of heathens around here. This ain't just Galilee. This is all the churches. We need somebody that's going to stand up and help us to clean the house. Well, the question is, Dr. Scott, how do you propose for us to get this house cleaned up? I'm so glad that you asked. The answer's right here in the text. First thing is, you got to deal with the problem head on. That's point number one. Deal with it. Deal with it. You can't skate around the issue. You can't ignore it and think that it's not there. You've got to deal with it. And that's what Paul says. Get everybody together and deal with this issue. Don't be afraid to address the issue openly. Don't be afraid to correct, confront, and challenge. Don't be afraid to look at the issue eye to eye. Don't dance around it. Don't act like if you ignore it, it's going away. There's things that you see in the church and you look the other way. No more. You need to have the courage to stand up and clean the house. Everybody sees and hears things. We need to have the courage to deal with it when it happens, so that people don't end up getting hurt in the church. This has gone on for too long in the Roman Catholic Church, with priests and ministers molesting children, having inappropriate relationships with people in the church. The devil is a liar. Then when the bishop finds out, you pay him a certain amount of money to sweep it under the table and act like it never happened. The devil is a liar. We need to stop inappropriate behaviors, especially with children and the defenseless. I came to kill a devil. You all know how I feel about my own children. Ah, come on, somebody. I'll get in your face for my kids. But not just my kids. Anybody's child should not be touched or molested in the church. Have I got a witness, church? And the truth is, so many people that are suffering with their own sexuality now, the reason why they're in that case is because somebody touched them in the wrong way in their childhood. And the cycle goes on and on and on. But I came to tell the devil the buck stops here. We need to have a safe sanctuary. We need to have an environment where you can leave your children.